Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to a continuation of our Q&A session for LinkedIn. I'm going to be starting by introducing the first two speakers today, Catherine Skefos and Katie Ozelius. They presented on Lynch Syndrome 101, Overview and Current State of the Art. And again, just a reminder that these presentations are on our LinkedIn website on the YouTube video. Catherine received an MS in genetic counseling from the University of Alabama at Birmingham in 2019. Prior to that, she received an MA in medical anthropology from the University of South Florida, where her research focused on healthcare access and health disparity. Catherine has a special interest in teaching, particularly educating healthcare providers and others about the benefits of genetic counseling and testing with the goal of improving patient access to genetic services. She joined the Dana-Farber genetics team in 2019 and provides genetic counseling for both pediatric and adult patients. And Katie received her MS in genetic counseling from the University of Michigan in 2019 and joined the Center for Cancer Genetics and Prevention at that time. She provides genetic counseling services to adult patients across a wide range of specialties. She has a special interest in communication within the healthcare system, particularly between providers in the delivery of genetic services. This session will be moderated by two of our excellent team of genetic counselors, Shraddha Gayankar and Fatima Amir.
Thank you so much, Anu. Welcome back, everyone. Let's get started. The first question is regarding breast cancer risk and Lynch syndrome, specifically the PMS2 gene.
Yeah, hi everyone. As Anu mentioned, my name is Katie. So we've had a lot of questions about breast cancer risk and Lynch syndrome. And at this point, we know that we do see breast cancer in some Lynch syndrome families that looks like it may be linked, but we just don't have enough evidence at this very moment to determine if there is a significantly increased risk for breast cancer in individuals with PMS2 mutations or anyone with Lynch syndrome. With that being said, it's important for us to note that, you know, in families where we see a lot of breast cancer, whether or not it's related to Lynch syndrome, oftentimes we do extra screening for those folks if we do think there's a significant enough risk for breast cancer. So if there is a lot of breast cancer in your family, like I said, regardless of whether or not it's linked to Lynch syndrome, your providers will look at that and determine if it's something that they need to think more about in terms of screening for you and your family.
Thank you, Katie. Fatima, do you want to ask the next question?
Yes, I just realized I was muted. Okay, so the next question we had is, how do I go about testing children? They are in their 30s and refuse to be tested. Is there an age recommendation?
This is a really important question and one that we run into in the clinic on a daily basis. Of course, we all, you know, as family members, think it's important for family members to have testing for something like Lynch syndrome. And we know that despite our best efforts, sometimes there are family members that don't want to get tested. So the first thing I want to say about this is that it's important not to put that pressure on yourself. Sometimes all we can do is tell our family members about the risks and, you know, connect them with services and things like that. From there, it does ultimately have to be their decision. One thing that can help in thinking about having this conversation with family members is to try to figure out a little bit more about what the resistance might be to having testing. For some people, they may just not understand how it can be relevant to them, especially if they're in a family where cancers have occurred at older ages. You know, maybe they think that there isn't a risk to them or that hasn't become as relevant to them. Sometimes being connected with a young adult patient advocacy group or something like that can help young adults to learn more about what those risks might be for their age group. The other factor that can sometimes come into play is just that some people find it or think that it would cause them more anxiety to know. And so that's also something that can be sort of worked through if they're willing to meet with a genetic counselor or a doctor, something like that. It's important to let family members know that just having the appointment with a genetic counselor or with a doctor doesn't mean they're going to be forced to have testing done. Some people may at least be open to having a conversation about testing, learning more, and then determining from there when the right time to get tested is. In terms of age recommendations for testing, typically we recommend that patients be at least 18 years old before they consider having genetic testing. Beyond that, the age range is can be more personalized. Some people wait until their 20s to be tested because that's the age at which screening recommendations may start. Some people want to know a little bit younger so that they can plan for this in the future. But anywhere over the age of 18 is a reasonable time for someone to be tested. If you do have unresolved questions about testing for family members or questions about how to get them connected with genetics resources, we encourage you to reach out to your providers so that they can help make those connections for you and help to think through some ways to have that conversation with family members as well.
Thank you so much, Catherine. The next question is regarding aspirin use in Lynch syndrome. Specifically, are there recommendations to use aspirin to deter prostate cancer in PMS2?
Yeah, so we can speak a little bit about this, but I do want to mention that there have been talks in the past, so like the keynote speaker from last year's conference, John Byrne, did a great talk on this titled, Should I Take Aspirin? So, I mean, as genetic counselors, we can say kind of broadly, we have studied aspirin use in terms of risk reduction for Lynch syndrome. And we have found with, I say we, but the researchers found with that study that, you know, that they think aspirin is helpful in terms of reducing risk for cancer with Lynch syndrome. I don't have great numbers or anything really specific to say about prostate cancer specifically in association with a PMS2 mutation. But I think we will learn more about it moving forward. And again, there are other great talks from specialists that really know a lot about the research that's been done, a lot about using aspirin in the context of Lynch syndrome. And also it's a great question for your doctors. You know, should I be taking aspirin? What are the benefits? All of that. I don't know, Catherine, if you have anything else to add to that.
This is Matt Yerglin. I would just echo that that Professor Byrne gave a phenomenal talk on this last year, which we have freely available on our YouTube channel. So I would encourage anybody who's interested in that to look at his talk, because I think he really hits on every aspect of aspirin. Plus, he's the world's expert on it, as he's the one who's led these studies.
Thank you, Katie and Matt. Okay, so the next question is, it seems the lifetime risk of ovarian cancer in Lynch syndrome, for instance, 4 to 20% in MLH1, is too wide a range to even be useful. Deciding whether or not to have surgery and enter early menopause for a 4% risk versus a 20% risk are very different scenarios. We need better data to make informed choices. Why is the ovarian cancer risk range so wide, and is there any progress towards refining this? Great question.
There are a few reasons why the numbers that we quote do have such a broad range, not just for ovarian cancer, but for other cancer types as well. And you know, we acknowledge that having these types of broad ranges can cause some confusion and frustration, especially when people are trying to make surgical decisions. One factor that goes into having a broad range like that has to do with variations that we see among different families with Lynch syndrome, not just between different genes, but even among families with the same genetic mutation. We see families that seem to fall toward that lower end of the spectrum, but we also see families that tend to fall toward that higher end of the risk spectrum. And so that's why family history becomes so important when helping a patient to understand their own risk and where they may fall on that spectrum. That can also help with determining things like options and timings for screening and risk-reducing surgeries. And we may learn more in the future about what does cause that variation in risk between families. Another factor that can come into play as we determine those estimates for cancer risk is how research studies are designed. So thinking back to when Lynch syndrome genes were first discovered, researchers discovered those genes in the first place by studying families where they saw much more cancer than expected in the general population. Those were the families with the most striking histories of cancer that led to the understanding in the first place. Over time, now that we are, you know, testing is more available, we're able to test more people, not only with cancer, but also people who are unaffected by cancer. And so that has brought to light more families that look different in their presentation of Lynch syndrome. So that in itself has improved our understanding of those overall cancer risks. There can also be differences between how different research studies are even formatted in the first place. So, you know, one study may look at lifetime cancer risks up to age 80, and another may look at up to age 70. So these are all factors that play in, whether the participants are undergoing active surveillance, whether they've had risk-reducing surgeries. All of these things factor into that calculation of risk. So again, we understand that this broad range can be frustrating, but it just underscores that importance of having a discussion with a provider who specializes in these kind of discussions and in Lynch syndrome to help understand and personalize what those risks might mean for you. And then from there, recommendations can be made for either risk-reducing surgery, screening options, or whatever the case may be, based on your family history, your genetic mutation, and things like that.
Thanks, Catherine. That was a great question. The next question is about direct-to-consumer test versus doing genetic testing through a genetic testing lab that a clinician does.
Yeah, so this is another great question. And I think as we move forward with genetics, and you know, there's more and more that we learn, there's more and more direct-to-consumer tests that come out. I think one of the things that I would say is that direct-to-consumer tests, they often aren't designed to look as comprehensively at the genes and the cancer syndromes that we would look at with a clinical test. And the other thing to note is that clinical labs, they typically are certified to do these tests, and their whole purpose is really to look at these genes and look really closely at these genes to try to determine if there's any mutations, if there's any hereditary cancer syndromes in the people that they do testing for. And I also know that there are some platforms where you can get your raw DNA data, you plug it in, and that platform kind of spits out to you a readout of, you know, mutations or syndromes that might be present and based on your DNA. And I think the other thing that we know is that those platforms are not always accurate. So sometimes they can be misleading, or they can, you know, tell you that things are there that maybe aren't there. And so I would say, you know, if you have testing through a clinical lab, that is usually our kind of our gold standard in terms of hereditary cancer testing. And if you get data from, you know, direct-to-consumer labs, sometimes the way that those direct-to-consumer labs analyze that data as well kind of plays into what that readout could be if you plug it into one of these other platforms. And it, again, it may not give you as accurate a reading as if you go through one of these clinical labs. So for us that, you know, do this clinical test all the time, we tend to trust them more than we would trust kind of some of these third-party platforms. I think that's my bottom line, is that at this point, the clinical tests are better designed to pick up those mutations and syndromes than some of these other tests. And Catherine, I don't know if you have anything else to add to the end of that.
I completely agree with what Katie said. I wanted to sort of tie in that something that Dr. Clure talked about in his lecture as well, which was, you know, thinking back to that sentence example that he used. The clinical labs that we send testing for, they are looking not only for misspellings in that sentence of our genes, they're looking for extra letters, missing words, extra words. All of those different types of mutations are what those clinical labs specialize in finding. And when it comes to doing direct consumer testing, so thinking about something like Ancestry.com or whatever the case may be, they just don't have that type of comprehensive analysis of our genetic information. They tend to essentially do little spot checks, looking at letters here and there to see what those letters say in you. but would easily miss a mutation in one of the genes related to Lynch syndrome.
Thank you. And one of the things I'll probably add to that is just with the direct-to-consumer testing, you know, there's most of the tests that you can get probably at your local drugstore and such, those are the ones that probably fall into that category. We are slowly seeing some clinical labs offer testing directly to the patient, where the patient can order the test with their doctor. And those are technically direct-to-consumer options too. But I would say, again, that would be something that you would want to make sure your provider is aware of as well. Okay. Next question we have is, are there any updates on management of risk, so in terms of screening, chemo prevention, prophylactic surgery for endometrial and ovarian cancer and Lynch syndrome for premenopausal women?
I can go ahead and answer that one real quick. I think our best answer for that is to refer you to last year's talk from Dr. Feltmate. She went over options for managing gynecologic cancer risks. And so I think that would be our way to give the most comprehensive answer in a short period of time. You can find that by going on to Dana-Farber's YouTube channel and searching for last year's LinkedIn conference.
Thanks, Catherine. The next one is, we received multiple questions about the other Lynch-related cancers beyond colon, uterine, ovarian, and do you have any comments about what, in terms of screening or medical management?
For these other cancers, I'm going to kind of talk pretty broadly about them. And the reason is because we do have a pretty clear recommendations for things like colon cancer, endometrial and uterine cancer, or endometrial and ovarian cancer, sorry, with Lynch syndrome. But these other cancers, the screening that we do is really based on personal and family history. So that's when it really is important to talk to your medical team, talk to the people that are most familiar with you and your family. To determine really what screening would be best for the other cancers that are associated with Lynch syndrome. Because for a lot of people that don't have certain cancers in their family, sometimes we're not doing any extra surveillance for those cancers. But if someone has a really strong history in their family of, you know, something like a urinary tract cancer, maybe that's something that we're thinking about for that family that we wouldn't think as much about for other families. So we certainly do screening for other cancers that are associated with Lynch syndrome, but it really just depends on kind of what we're seeing in the family, what we're seeing in the individual, and what we think would be kind of best practice for screening that family.
Okay, great. The next question is, genetics showed that I have MLH1, and they said that this mutation blocked the ability to see PMS2. Does this mean I possibly have two mutations?
So I can start fielding this question, and of course, if Katie or the other GCs would like to add on, that'd be great. So it sounds like this question is talking about the difference between what we call germline genetic testing versus tumor immunohistochemistry testing, IHC for short. So when it comes to the germline testing, that's looking at the genetic information that someone was born with to see if they have Lynch syndrome. When it comes to the tumor testing part of things, what this is looking at is the protein expression that we see in the tumor itself. And in terms of someone who has an MLH1 mutation in their germline, which leads to that diagnosis of Lynch syndrome, we can see that influencing the expression of other proteins right there within the tumor cell. And that's because these proteins all work together in order to perform that function of mismatch repair that Dr. Klor was talking about. And so it sounds to me like in the tumor, it was blocking the MLH1 and the PMS2. And that's a pattern that we can see in this type of case. But likely it doesn't mean that there's a second mutation there.
Yeah, and I'll just add to that. So Catherine did touch on this. Basically, the proteins, so again, what Dr. Klor was talking about, kind of what the DNA eventually produces, they work in pairs in terms of this mismatch repair in the body. So these Lynch syndrome genes make these proteins that then work together, like Catherine said. And the MLH1 and PMS2 proteins are typically working together in your body to do the job that they need to do. So that's why sometimes in a Lynch syndrome tumor, we see both, you know, MLH1 and PMS2 missing, because usually they're working together. And if there's an MLH1 mutation that's causing MLH1 not to work properly, then oftentimes we're not seeing PMS2 either because they're paired. And similar with MSH2 and MSH6, they often pair in the body as well.
Thank you so much, Catherine and Katie O.